Good to see you guys. As Sam mentioned earlier, we begin a new series today that we're super excited about. And we are going to be traveling over the summer, if you will, through the book of Psalms. And we have been talking about this. We've been praying about this for the past several months as an elder team. We've been just kind of working some different ideas, and kind of what we landed on was we want to approach the Psalms and kind of take an overview of all the Psalms. If you notice, there's 150 Psalms that's recorded in our Old Testament. And so as you read through the Psalms, you'll notice there's certain patterns or types of Psalms that we find throughout there. And so what our plan is for the summer is to look at some of these different categories or types of Psalms, right? To kind of create a blueprint for our church community so that when you're reading through the Psalms, which we really hope that you will, and we'll talk more about how we're going to hopefully incorporate that more into our church community. But as you're reading through the Psalms, you'll have a framework or a blueprint of when I get to a psalm about wisdom, when I get to a psalm of praise, right? What should I know about that? How should I see that and kind of work in that? And so that's where we're going to be going. But this morning, we want to start with a little bit of a introduction, a background, if you will, to understanding what the book of Psalms is, like what we find there, how we should understand it, who wrote it, kind of all of those important questions, right? But when I think about the Psalms, right, I think about music, right? And in the same way that music, right, has the ability to transport us back to another time period in our life. You guys ever notice that? You ever been listening to the radio and an old song came on the radio and it just like brought you back to a moment earlier in your life, right? I was thinking through that this week, and there's a couple of songs as I was thinking through that were kind of these timeline markers in my life. Now, I will have to let you guys know, I grew up in the 80s and 90s, right? And so primarily in the 90s, so most of this music is 90s music. I just want to kind of put the warning out there. If you've never heard this before, it's probably okay. But I think we have a couple different songs out there. Aaron, we'll go ahead and hit the first one. I think it says song one on there. See if anybody recognizes this lovely melody from the 90s. Just a couple of, I see some smiles. I see some confusion. You guys, anybody with me? Anybody remember this? All right, this was from Space Jam soundtrack, right? And when, we should have played a little game this morning and had prizes. When I think about this song, I think about sixth grade middle school dance, slow dance moment right here, sixth grade, song number one. Okay, let's go on to song number two and see if you guys recognize this. Some of you guys do. Anybody with me? Anybody know who this is? Go ahead and call it out if you know who it is. Dave Matthews, anybody know the song? I know, all the songs kind of sound the same. But it's called Ants Marching by Dave Matthews, right? And so when I hear this song, what goes through my mind is sitting on a school bus, riding to school, coming back from school every day through high school. Like, I had Dave Matthews playing every day on the ride back home. Okay, this next one, let's see if any of you guys recognize this. This is getting a little bit closer to the 2000s. Any of you guys, okay, Kryptonite by, anybody? Three Doors Down, okay. So this song, I remember we took a band trip to St. Louis, Missouri, and on the trip, one day we were supposed to all stay at the hotel with the band leaders, but a few of my friends decided that this album came out, Three Doors Down, their first album came out, and so we decided that we were going to sneak out of the hotel and go buy the album at a record store. This was before the days of GPS, right? So we basically just aimlessly wandered through the streets of St. Louis. What could possibly go wrong? And I'll save you the whole story, but basically the trip ended by us getting chased by some people back to the hotel, and it's a whole story I can tell you later. But that's what comes to mind when I hear that song. Okay, last song. This was kind of 2000s. I know at least one person in here will know this song, maybe two. Anybody? POD. Southtown. Close. Yes. So this right here was like the theme song from like 18 to 25 of my life, right? This was what I wanted to be in my life. I wanted to, I was a part of a band, right? I think I've told you guys that before. Our band was called Blue Light Special. Any of you guys old enough to remember the Kmart Blue Light Special? That's exactly what we named our band after. And this was what we wanted. This is the sound that we wanted. Now, we didn't even come close to that, right? But what I love about music, right, is it has a way of transporting us into a moment, right? In the same way, the Psalms, right, are written to transport us to a place of worship before God, right? The intentionality, the purpose of the Psalms is to transport us into, right, into a moment where we can come together and we can learn to praise God. Now, the Psalms, right, as are written, our first kind of question today is, what are the Psalms, right? What are the Psalms? And the answer is the Psalms are a collection of prayers and praises to God, right? So you think through your life, you think through those moments of your life, right, where you have been just in prayer, in just intimate relationship communication with God, right? And for the psalm writers, they just wrote down those moments, right? As they were guided by the Spirit of the Lord, they wrote down those moments, and that's what the Psalms are. It's a collection. Daniel Henderson, I love what he said. He says, in today's language, the Psalms are the soundtrack of God's redemptive history, right? They're a collection of praises and songs that were written to talk about what God has done to redeem his people back to himself. And so what do we learn from the Psalm? That's our next question we want to kind of look at today. What do we learn from the Psalms? And what we learn from the Psalms are things like attributes of God. We learn about who God is. We learn about theology, right? What God is like. What is his ability? What is God able to do? What is God's nature like? And we learn practical ways to communicate with God. Again, Daniel Henderson, who, by the way, Daniel Henderson is the guy who wrote the Praying the Psalms. This is the resource that we are suggesting for this series. If you're a paper person, then we would suggest you get this book. It's called Praying Through the Psalms by Daniel Henderson, and it's basically just prayer prompts with a little devotion and then prayer prompts through each one of the Psalms, so 150 of the Psalms. And we're going to be going through that here this summer, and so we'll talk a little bit more about that. But for right now, let's get back to what he said. Henderson says this about what we can learn from the Psalms. He says, imagine if you go back through your life and write a song for each defining moment, every heartache, every celebration, every trial, every battle, every victory God already has for you. It's called the Book of Psalms. You see, what I love about Psalms is that we can find a moment for everything we experience in life in the Book of Psalms. If you go through heartache in this life, which we will, right? The Book of Psalms has a place to connect there. If you're going through celebration of something, the Book of Psalms has that. If you're going through trials and heartache and victory and battle, they're all found in the Book of Psalms. So, next question then, as we continue this introduction, right? Who wrote the Book of Psalms? Who wrote the Book of Psalms? Well, the Book of Psalms is a collection by many different authors, right? There's a collection of many different authors. Now, the majority of the Psalms were written by King David of the Bible, and he wrote about 75 of these 150 Psalms. Next comes Asaph. He wrote 12. The sons of Korah, which is really was kind of like the worship leader. So as we had our worship leaders up here this morning leading us in worship, right? The sons of Korah was a group of worship leaders. They wrote 11 Psalms. And then there's a few other random people in there. My favorite in the list is a guy named Heman. Because when I read that, I think about He-Man. Now, how many of you guys from the 80s remember He-Man and the Masters of the Universe? Anybody remember He-Man? Right? Not the same guy, evidently. Okay? Not the same guy. So don't be thinking about that guy. But there was a guy named He-Man, Solomon. Moses actually wrote one of the Psalms in here, is accredited to Moses. So these are a collection, right? And 48 of the Psalms are anonymous. They don't have an author's name attached to them. Interestingly, though, the Psalms were written over nearly a 1,000-year period from the lifetime of Moses in the wilderness all the way up until the time of Ezra in the 4th century BC, right? And so it's this long-standing collection, right, of praises that were written to God, about God, for His people, which is kind of our next question is, who were the Psalms written for? And this is really important for us to understand, okay? Really important for us to understand. The Psalms were written to ancient Israelites, okay? So as you are reading some of the language and some of the references, you'll notice there are some cultural things that are used, right? God is referred to as a rock, right? Because again, in ancient Israel, right, the rock was kind of that picture. If you wanted to build your house on a solid foundation, right, it was before the days of cement and concrete and things like that, right? You would find a rock bed or a bedrock, if you will, right? And you would build your house on that because it was a solid foundation. And so the psalm writers compare God to that, right? So there's some cultural elements, right? Because it was written to ancient Israelites as they were pursuing and following after Yahweh, their God. These psalms were also often recited at holidays and celebrations, but they are also written for everyone, okay? So they were written to the ancient Israelites, but they were also written for everyone, which is why today in 2023, we can come to the book of Psalms and we can read about these moments and they still apply to our life today. Because as our worship team just led us in this morning, they truly are the Word of God. And so as the Word of God, they don't change. They're constant. And so their application is constant. No matter what we're going through in life, no matter how much our world changes around us, God's Word doesn't change. Excuse me. So then that leads us to our next question, which is, what is the purpose of the Psalms? Right? What is the purpose of the Psalms? Well, in order to understand the purpose of the Psalms, we also have to look at the structure of the Psalms, right? Now, while you will find a variety of Psalms throughout that are kind of intermingled, right? If you just kind of zoom out and do like the 50,000-foot view, right, for just a second of the book of Psalms, right? If you just kind of zoom out and look at Psalms as a whole, what you'll notice in general is that the Psalms start out in heavy lament, sorrow, heartache, just the deep, hard stuff of life. But as you read through the Psalms, as you get to the second half of Psalms, you start to notice there's a transition from lament to praise, from sorrow to joy. And so overall, what we can look at the book of Psalms is that the psalmists are trying to lead us as they've been collected together. These psalms are trying to point us that when we put our trust in God, our hearts can move from a place of sorrow and grief to a place of joy and contentment, right? And as we read through the Psalms, it takes us on that journey. And so our hope is, over the summer, as we root ourselves in the book of Psalms, that we will be able to move from a place of sorrow to joy in our own lives. Now, I thought this morning, instead of me getting up here and saying, hey guys, as a church, here's why you should read the book of Psalms. Here's what's important for you to know about reading the Psalms, right? Instead, I've asked one of our church body members, Tyler, to come, and he's going to share with us for just a minute a testimony of what the Psalms have meant to him and the impact they've had on his life. So kind of following up a little bit from what Tyler just kind of shared with us this morning, what should we expect, right? What should be the expectations as we walk through this series over the next 13 weeks or so? Number one is that we would learn to speak with God through Scripture. Tyler mentioned about the importance of just repeating God's Word back to Him, right? How many times have you prayed something and you've had the thought in your mind, God, if I just knew what Your will was, then I would ask You for that thing, right? But we have it, right? When we pray scripture to God, right? We're praying what God has already said His will is and what His will is to be, right? And so it provides a way for us to pray scripture back to God. Now, we want to be able to do that in a very practical way during this series, right? We want to be able to do this in such a way that we make it an easy on-ramp, right, for everyone in our church community to be able to join in and to start doing this, right? And so what we've done is we've created a page on our website. If you are a kind of tech person at all, if you don't mind getting on websites and accessing information digitally, right, we have created a page on our website. If you go to bedrockfc.com/callout, right, which is our series, Call Out, if you go to bedrockfc.com/callout, you will find a weekly list. All right, and it'll be listed on there by the day, and you'll click on the link day one. So today starts day one. So today you get on, you go to bedrockfc.com/callout. You click week one, which is going to say wisdom, because we're reading about wisdom this week. And day one, which is today, you click on that link, it's going to open up a PDF, right, that's going to just have some prayer prompts to kind of help walk through Psalm 1, which is what we're covering today. And it's going to just give you a starting point, right? It's going to give you some just practical starting points to be able to get in and to start praying through God's Word. Sometimes the hardest part is just getting started, right? How many of you guys ever been like to the gym for the first time, right? The hardest part of going to the gym or going back to the gym is just getting started. And so these prayer prompts are not meant to tell you what to pray or how to pray to God, but to just give you an easy on-ramp to start praying the scripture, the word of the Psalms back to God and how to incorporate that into your life. Now, we also mentioned and we also know that some people, they're just not digital people, right? And there's nothing wrong with that. In fact, when I'm reading something, I actually prefer to read a paper version of that, right? And so we've been talking about this book. If you want to utilize the book instead to kind of go through that and to help you with the prayer prompts instead of the digital, at the back table, at the red table back there, there are some paper calendars that's going to tell you which psalm we're going through each day. And so for today, for example, you would just go to Psalm 1, which would be here at the very beginning, right? And you're just going to read through the devotion, and then you're going to read through the same prayer prompts that we're going to be doing together, right? It's just going to be, this is in a paper copy. If you do it through the website, it's in a digital copy. But we want to encourage, we want everyone in our church community to be able to come around God's Word and to learn how to speak the Scriptures back to God, to pray through the Scriptures. That's the first thing that we hope. Secondly is that, as Tyler mentioned, that you would abide, that you would learn to spend time with God. As we've gone through 1st, 2nd, 3rd Psalm and Jude over this past season of teaching, right? One of the things that it's talked about over and over again is the importance of abiding. And this is a practical way for us just to spend time with God. It creates a habit and a routine for us to regularly devote our time with God. You see, if Jesus is our greatest example of how we should live, right? In the New Testament, right, His followers were called Talmudim, which means His disciples or apprentices. And the way that they learned how to follow Jesus was by watching what He did, right? And so if Jesus is our master, of all the books, right, that are quoted in the New Testament, the Psalm by far and away is the one that's quoted the most. If you go back and look at the words of Jesus, you'll see that He quotes the words from the Psalms more than He quotes anywhere else, right? In fact, Jesus quotes directly from the Psalms over 50 times in the gospel account. Is it no wonder that when Jesus was on the cross, the words that came out of His mouth were a quote from the Psalms? And so if Jesus learned and prayed through the Psalms, shouldn't we do that as well if we want to be His disciples? If we want to follow after our Master Jesus, right? It's important that we learn to pray the things that He prayed. And Jesus very evidently, was highly connected to the Psalms. So here's just a question I want you to think about, okay? What if you could do one thing over this summer that would completely change your relationship with God? Right? Not to sound like a late night infomercial or anything like that, a sales pitch, right? But think about it for a second. If there was one practice that you could put into your life and say after 13 weeks, right, it would change the way that you communicated with God. I can't think of a better practice than praying back God's word to him, than praying through scripture. And I can't think of a better place to begin that than to start praying through a book that was a book of prayers, right? It's almost as if the Holy Spirit knew we would need a guide to help us in that. And he provided that, right? I can promise you that if we spend the next 13 weeks together searching through and praying through God's word, that it will radically change our relationship with him, right? And so we want to focus this series not just on going through and teaching through the Psalms, but teaching us how to pray through the Psalms, right? Which then raises our last question that we need to talk about today, and that is this: what is prayer? Well, I guess it's two questions. And how do we pray, right? What is prayer and how do we pray? Well, you may say, what is prayer? A very common definition of prayer may just be talking to God, right? There's nothing wrong with that definition. It's absolutely what prayer is. It's communication with God. But Alvin Reed, I think, came up with a much better definition to understanding what prayer should be. He said it this way. He said, a biblical definition of prayer is intimacy with God that leads to the fulfillment of his purposes. It's an intimacy with God. First and foremost, prayer is intimacy. It's relationship. It's spending time out of a delight, out of a heart of joy with God. And the purpose of that, or the result of that, is that we then begin to fulfill his purposes. I love how Corrie Ten Boom put it this way. She said, is prayer your steering wheel or your spare tire? Think about that for just a second. When we utilize prayer, is it the thing that guides our life, that we are constantly going to guide our life? Or is it the thing that we run to when we get into an emergency? When we hit the pothole in the road and we get the flat tire, oh, let me pull the prayer out and go to God. God, please help me and fix this situation. Be with my bum knee and be with my great aunt. And this, like, when we go through these emergency situations, or is it the constant steering wheel of our life? That as we're going through life, that we're constantly in intimate communication with God. I hope it's a steering wheel for us this morning, right? So the last question that we must endeavor to go through this morning is this. Is prayer individual or is it corporate? Is it individual? Is it just something that I should do in my closet alone? Or is it something that the church should do together? And the answer to that question is yes, right? Throughout Scripture, you're going to see that we're called to both pray individually, privately, but also overwhelmingly, we're called to pray corporately as well. In fact, when you look at, for example, Jesus's prayer that he taught his disciples, if you go back and look at the words that he uses, in fact, we're going to do that in just a second. If you look at the words that Jesus used in that prayer, what you'll notice is that the words that he used are in the plural. It was a corporate prayer, right? Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will. Give us this day our daily bread, right? Over and over again, when you see the prayers in Scripture, they're often intended for a community. And so we want to pray not just individually, but as a church community when we come together and be, as Tyler said, a house of prayer. Excuse me. So that leads us to the question, then how do we do it, right? That's the question. How do we pray? Is it just talking to God? I'll say, yes, that's part of it, right? But I think it's also important that we realize that prayer should also be intentional. There can be intentionality in the way that which we pray. And in fact, when Jesus taught his disciples to pray, he taught them a specific prayer that could be a model for them, right? Not that it was the word specifically, but it could be a model for them to be able to learn how to pray to God, how to speak to God. And there were four elements that Jesus taught him. Now, I'm not going to tell you how they correlate because I'm going to actually have you guys do that here in just a second. But let me just quickly give you the four elements that Jesus incorporated when he taught his disciples how to pray, right? And an easy way to remember that is just by directional, right? So first of all is up, right? up, which is reverence, right? When we pray, we begin with an acknowledgement of God and who He is, right? A.W. Tozer famously said, "What comes into our minds when we think about God is the most important thing about us." He said, "Worship is pure or based as the worshiper entertains either a high or low thoughts of God." And so the starting point for us when we begin praying is to think about God, right? Our task, if you will, is to seek the face of God before we ever seek the hands of God, right? We're seeking to know God's face before we ever are asking Him to give us things that maybe we need or that we want. And so we begin with God. And so maybe you begin your prayer with something like this. What has God revealed about Himself in Scripture? So as you read through the Psalms, as Tyler pointed out, as you're reading through a psalm and you point out a name of God or an attribute of God, right? That's an easy way to turn that into a praise for who God is. And first of all, we start with up, which is reverence. Second of all, we start with down, which is our response, right? Once we know who God is, now we move to a place of surrender, right? As it relates to who we are. And so we ask the question, how do I honor or respond to what God has already revealed about Himself? Third, we move out inwardly, right? Inwardly, which is our request. We simply ask God for the things that we need. What are our needs that we have today? And typically they fall into two categories: resources, things like jobs and money and health and work, and relationships, things with our coworkers and our family and our friends around us, right? What are the needs? What are the requests that we're having, that we're asking God for? After we've acknowledged who God is, after we've responded to who God is, after we've asked our request of God, the last element of that is out, It's our readiness. As we prepare to go out into a world to live in a spiritual battle every single day as we wake up and we battle against, right, the world and our flesh and the enemy, right? As we have those battles every single day in our life, we must be prepared for that. Right? And so we're asking questions or we're asking God that we're always prepared and ready. And so maybe you may pray something like, how should I apply this to my life? So simply, let me just go over one more time. It's up, reference, down, response, in, request, out, readiness. Right? Those four elements. And we can find those in the example that Jesus gave to His disciples. And so here's what we want to do for just a second. We want to encourage you guys, right, to get into groups of people that are sitting close to you this morning. Circle up three or four people that are sitting around you. And I want you to read through Matthew chapter 6, verses 9 through 13, which is the Lord's Prayer. And see if you can point out in your groups all four of those elements, the up, down, in, and out. I have them right here listed, the questions and what they talk about, right? And so let's take a few minutes and talk about that together, okay? Our kids are going to meet in the back with Mr. Sam and Miss Cassandra this morning, right? And they're going to also ask some questions that relate to how Jesus taught us to pray. So they're going to ask questions about what does it mean for God to be our Father, and how do we keep His name holy, and why should we want God's plan to happen here on earth. So let's take a few minutes together. Let's look at that corporately together. See if you guys can point those things out, and then we'll come back together and we'll see how you guys did on that little exercise. I'm just going to walk through the Lord's Prayer with you real quickly. Let's just see how you guys did as you came up in your discussion. So Lord's Prayer starts out with, "Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be your name," right? Which part does that include? Would you say that would be the up, down, in, or out? Up, right? It's focusing on God, who is our Father, who is in heaven, and we're praising, hallowed be your name, right? And then the second part, your kingdom come, your will be done. What is that? Down, right? That's our response. When we come to understand that God is heavenly Father who is in control of everything, right? I can ask that his purposes and his will happen here on earth as they already are in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us of our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. What is that? In, right? As we think about what are our daily needs, right? But also part of our daily needs could be relational as well, right? Maybe part of my daily needs is that I'm having a fractured relationship, and I need to ask God to forgive me of my sins so that I can forgive someone else. Right? So that those requests and those relational requests can happen as well. And then the last one, our last part of that is lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one, right? Would be what? Out, right? Prepare us. Prepare us as we go out into the world, that we can live in such a way that we would elevate the name of Jesus. Now, this is an important passage, right? This is how Jesus taught his disciples how to pray. So I think it creates an importance for us, right? But this isn't the only place that we see that. In fact, I got a little homework assignment for you guys this week, okay? I want to encourage you guys to read Acts chapter 4, verses 24 through 31, and see if you can discover the up, down, in, and out elements of that as well, right? As you read that, you're going to notice that as Jesus taught his disciples how to pray in this way, his disciples actually taught those that they were discipling the same thing. Can you imagine that? Right? So when you read through this prayer in Acts chapter 4, you're going to notice that those same elements are incorporated in that, which is why, as we are teaching through the book of Psalms, we actually want to look at the book of Psalms. We just want to kind of lay this idea of praying, right, up, down, in, and out. We want to lay this idea kind of over the book of Psalms as we look through Psalms in order to help us pray better through the book of Psalms. And so today we wanted to start with, why should we be praying through the book of Psalms, right? And in Psalm 1, as Kirk read for us this morning, Psalm 1 actually answers that question of why we should pray through the Psalms. Why is it important, right? And the big idea that we get in Psalm chapter 1 is if we want to be wise people, we're going to root our lives in the Word of God. We're going to root ourselves in the Word of God. So again, we're going to just kind of lay this up, down, in, and out over top of Psalm 1 and just kind of see what we learn. Okay, so let's do this together this morning, okay? Psalm 1, okay? Let's look at the first thing, which is the up, right? What does Psalm 1 teach us about God? Hopefully you have your Bibles with you this morning and you're open to Psalm 1. And as you look at Psalm 1, there's a few things we learn about God from this passage. First of all, Psalm 1 begins by saying, blessed is the man. Let's just stop right there, right? First thing we learn is that God is the source of blessing, right? In order to be blessed, it doesn't come from ourselves, but it comes from God. In fact, if we jump down to verse 6, the very last verse of Psalm 1, he says, "For the Lord knows the way of righteousness, but the way of the wicked will perish." You see, God is the source of blessing, and he's also our sustainer, and he's also our judge, right? God knows where wisdom comes from. He knows the way of righteousness, right? And if we want to be blessed people, we have to first acknowledge that blessing is not anything that we bring to the table, but it's something that our God does for us. Now, when you hear that word blessed, right, I would assume that there's probably 1,000 definitions going through your mind this morning, right? In fact, I think as a culture, we've kind of hijacked this term blessed, right? And we've turned it into a very little pithy saying, right? Hashtag blessed, it just means that, like, hey, everything's wonderful, there's no problems, like, life is great, hashtag blessed, right? But a biblical understanding of blessing means the Bible understands that word blessing to refer to a life that is flourishing, a multiplication of life. And so as we read in Genesis chapter 1, when God created the heavens and the earth, right? And he filled it with plants and animals and people. He said that he blessed his creation. And the result of that was that it multiplied, that it flourished, that life was good, and life continued to produce. And so if we want to understand what it means to be a blessed person, we have to understand that God wants to produce that in our life. And it says in verse 6 that the Lord knows. That word in the Hebrew to know that's used right there in verse 6 is the Hebrew word yada. Everybody say yada. Okay, so now you can tell all your friends that you learned something at church this morning. Hebrew yada means to know. And it speaks of God knowing us intimately in other places. In Hebrew, it's a participle that refers to an action or a condition in an unbroken, continuous kind of way. So God doesn't just know one thing about us, but God knows everything there ever will be to know about us. And so as the one who knows everything about us, God also knows what leads to our blessing, to our flourishing, to our best life, if you will, to use some of our cultural narrative, right? God knows what is best for us, even when we don't understand that ourselves. And so as we look at Psalm 1, the first thing we must acknowledge is that God is the source of blessing, and that He knows best, better than we do. And so we must ask ourselves as we begin to look at Psalms, do we trust His wisdom? Do we trust His wisdom? Next, what is our response? Well, let's continue reading in verse 1, right? Let's continue reading in verse 1. It says, "Blessed is the man who walks not in the counsel of the wicked, nor stands in the way of sinners, nor sits in the seat of scoffers." Right? If I understand that God is a source of blessing, I realize that all of these other things lead me away from the blessing that God wants to have in my life, the flourishing that God wants for me. You know, if we look at that, we realize that our response to understanding God as the source of blessing and all wisdom is that we must walk down, as we all walk down a path by nature that leads to wickedness, we must repent in those moments. We must turn from those things that lead us astray and walk back to God. Notice what he says about the wise man, right? He chooses to turn away from the counsel of the wicked. He chooses to not stand in the way of sinners, and he chooses not to sit with scoffers. I heard someone say it this way: if you walk with the sinners, you will soon linger as a sin. I'm sorry. If you walk with the wicked, you will soon linger with the sinners, and before long, you will be stuck like a scoffer. Right? Think about it for just a second, right? He's talking about what are the influences in our life. We're going to realize that the Psalm 1 is going to call us, right, to put out those influences in our life so that we can focus on God, who is the source of blessing. So our response is that as we are walking down the path of life, if we start to follow after the wicked, the evil, the things that are against God, that we must change directions and start to follow God, right? That's our response. Second, the inward part. What is our request? What are the things that we're asking for? Notice what he says in verse 2. "But his delight is in the law of the Lord, and on his law he meditates day and night." Is that the inward request of your heart? Is that the place that your heart yearns for? I love that it uses the word delight. Would you say that your delight is in the word of the Lord? Would you say that you find the most joy in your life by spending time in the presence of God? Or does it feel more like a duty sometimes? You see, oftentimes in our life that we look at the Word of God and it seems more like a responsibility or a duty that we have to do more than a delight. But the blessed person here in Psalm 1 is someone who sees the Word of God as a delight, as a joy, as something that I want to fill my life with. Notice also this person doesn't just quickly read over the Word of God, but it says that he or she meditates, that he slowly enjoys every bit of the Word of God, right? And I get this distinction. You see, in my house we have 6 boys and we have 5 girls, right? Here's what I notice when we sit down at the dinner table. The boys, there's not a whole lot of room for delighting in the meal. It's, let me get in as much as I can, as quick as I can, right? So that I can get more before all my other brothers eat what's left, right? But the girls, my girls, I'll notice, man, they are delighting in that meal. They will take a bite, and then they'll have conversation, and they'll chat about things, and they'll take another bite, and they'll chat. And they'll be at the dinner table long past the boys. The boys are just trying to get it in as quick as they can just to move on to the next thing. But the girls just delight and enjoy that time together. I think that's what Psalm 1 is calling us to, is that we would delight in the Word of God. That we would find the Word of God to be a joy that we delight in. And so if that's true, if we begin to delight in the Word of God, right? The last part of that we see in Psalm 1, the outward part of that, right? The readiness part of that is that we develop deep roots that will not be blown away. Look at verse 3. Speaking of the blessed man, he said, he is like a tree planted by the streams of water that yields its fruit in its season, and its leaf does not wither. In all that he does, he prospers. Verse 4, but the wicked are not so, but they are like chaff that the wind blows away. Right? Here's the picture, right? There's two different pictures. There's one that's a tree that is planted, deeply rooted in the Word of God, that's abiding in, that's dug down into the Word of God. And it's saying that this tree, that it flourishes, that there's blessing. And here's the beautiful thing. The blessing of this tree isn't just for the tree itself, right? If you've ever seen a giant tree, we have giant oak trees in our front yard. What I love about having the oak trees in our front yard, aside from the leaves every fall, what I love about the oak trees, though, is to look out and to see all of the wildlife that these trees are providing shelter for, providing food for, providing nourishment for. And what Psalm 1 is telling us is if we root our lives in God, yes, we get a blessing from it, but we also get to become a blessing to those around us. We get to provide nourishment to those around us, and that's what it's calling for here. You see, in the Middle Eastern culture, where Psalm 1 was written, right, there were two bodies of water. There were two bodies of water. Does anybody know what they were? Quickly, a little Bible trivia here. So the Sea of Galilee and the Dead Sea, right? There are two giant bodies of water, right? And I think we got a picture, right? So this is the Sea of Galilee, and this is the Dead Sea. And one of the things you'll notice is that surrounding the Sea of Galilee, right? There's life. There's flourishing. There's all of this life that's happening. But around the Dead Sea, there's nothing, right? Which is why it's called the Dead Sea. Now, do you guys know what the difference in those two are? Good and evil. Yes. I love it. This is why I love having the kids in here. In the Sea of Galilee, it has an inlet, so it has rivers that pour into it, but it also has an outlet where it sends the water out to other places as well. The Dead Sea has inlets that pour into it, but has no outlets for the water to go out. So there's no way to push out the rest of the water. And so everything is just dead in the Dead Sea, right? And I think that's a beautiful illustration of our lives sometimes, right? As we want to become people who are blessed and filled with the Word of God, right? We also have to realize that it's not just for us, but we should also be pouring out the things that God is pouring into our lives as well. We should be like the Sea of Galilee that's getting life poured into us, but then also letting life flow out from us. Because it says that the person who is wise, who is in the Word of God, meditating on the Word of God, that everything that person does will prosper. But on the other hand, the wicked are like the chaff, right? The chaff is like, if you've ever had like a grain or something, right? It's like that outer shell that comes off of it, right? If you kind of rub it together, the outer shell will kind of come off and you can just blow it, right? And it just kind of blows wherever. And so it's calling us, right, to be people of wisdom. It's calling us to be people who root our lives into the Word of God. And that's exactly what we want to call our church to be this morning. We want to call us to be a people who have rooted our lives into the Word of God. And so would you join us, church? Would you join us over this summer as we dig our lives into the Word of God, as we walk through a good majority of the Psalms we find in Scripture? Not only would you read through those with us, but would you pray through those with us as well? And so we want to just give a moment for response this morning, okay? So here's how we want to do response this morning. We want to just give each person here a moment to just ask God at the beginning of this series. We just want to give you a moment to ask God to start to develop those deep roots found in the Word of God in your life, okay? And so we got our prayer prompt up this morning. Aaron, I think it's the next slide category down for our prayer prompts this morning. Move on down to the next, underneath the sermon. There you go. And so here's what we want to do. I want to give you guys just a couple of minutes before our worship team comes to close this out. And maybe you begin your prayer with something like this. God, give me deep roots in your word today. And then you just ask God for that. You just approach God and ask him, right, to give you deep roots. as we study through and as we dive into His Word and we look at the book of Psalms over this series, that you would ask God to start to develop those deep roots in your life so that you may be a person of blessing, right? Blessing that you would receive, but then also blessing that you would take and pour out into other people. And so let's just take a few minutes this morning. And after you guys have had a few minutes to pray, our worship team is going to come and lead us in one last song together.